this is the biography of Cirac, and then just all the information regarding the institute. And this is the press release in English. I have one also in Italian.
Okay, let's start. Well, good morning to everybody. Thank you to all of you who have been coming here to join us for this special event. Thank you for everybody to join us. Today is very special because it's the starting point, we think, of a major initiative in Trieste. We call it the TQT, is the Trieste Institute for the Theory of Quantum Technologies. And it's a collaboration that we announced already essentially 1 year ago at the event of the Dirac Medal ceremony last year. And today we bring it to the conclusion by the official signature of the agreement collaboration between the three institutions. SISSA, the University of Trieste, and ICTP. So it's a real pleasure to have this kind of events, and we can show the three institutions being very, very close and working together. Actually, I thank the scientists from each of the institutions, in particular also to Stefano Maurizio for joining us in this collaboration. We have great expectations, not only for the region, but also for the mission of ICTP to promote also this big field, which is getting more and more important with time, to have it available to as many possible scientists as possible worldwide. And so I think that starting with this initiative could be a beginning of something big. As you can, you know that there's this flagship project from the European Union that is promoting this field of quantum technologies, and we would like to be a very important component of that project. And within the region, there is a lot of interest, and there is already some expertise in the different institutions that we put them, all of them together, could make it much bigger as the sum of its parts. So in that sense, we are looking forward for this special event. And so before proceeding to the signing ceremony, I would like to ask Stefano Maurizio to say a few words.
Okay. Oh, thank you very much for this having organized this event. I think it's a great thing for Trieste, for the Trieste system, which is not made only by ICTP in SISSA and the University of Trieste, but it's an entire system that is moving towards new frontiers of science and technology. Here the point is perhaps not the quantum technology, but rather the data. Data everywhere. Data is going to be the very big change that we were going to face in the next, I would say, 10 years, perhaps 20 years. We will be submerged by data. And you know, I was a teacher of database at my university, and I always told my students that data and information is different. You don't have information if you are not able to extract the information from the data. And that's the point. Already now, data science and scientific computing are covering a paramount importance in the development of the, let's say, infrastructures of developed countries. And when I say data everywhere, this is the situation, because we have the Internet of Things, which is creating an enormous amount of data. But tomorrow, and will be tomorrow morning, we will have the Internet of Nano Things, with terrible and incredible implications in what is called the virtual twins, the digital twins. Internet of Nano Things will generate and collect and transport an enormous amount of biological data. It's not science fiction thinking that each one of us will have a digital twin stored somewhere in a big data environment. And all this, again, I said, is not science fiction. This is actually what will happen. And in order to deal with all this data, we need at least three things, but at least, I'm saying at least three things. First, computer power. High-performance computing, even though the new, let's say, development of the petaflop technology will suffer from data transmission. There will be no problem in coupling, in getting an enormous amount of information done, but the transmission among CPUs will be one of the problems. The storage will be the second problem. The algorithm will be a problem, but probably the most important one will be data transmission and cybersecurity. You can imagine how challenging would be a possible potential hacker, perhaps at the service of some political party, hackering data of regular people. This is very scary. This has happened. This has happened in the US, not in terms of Internet of Nano Things, of course, but that was a signal, very important signal. So in this respect, I think what we are starting today now in Trieste, and it's not a case that we started in Trieste, this adventure, is let's study quantum computing, but not only computing, quantum communication in general, because we are facing in the future an evolution which will be non-linear. Today, up to now, in computer science, we experience a sort of linear development, exponential perhaps, but expectable results were achieved. In the future, this will not be the case. I'm convinced that quantum computing will not solve all the problems we have so far, but will be with quantum computing and quantum technology, so especially for data transfer, we will be able to tackle problems. And most probably, knowing the quality and the quantity of work done here in Trieste, also give some, let's say, suggestion for technology transfer to industries. Big industries, IBM, Google, are very much involved in this, but also Eurotech, thank you, Siagri, for being here. They are also very active in this. So it's not a quantum technology in the cloud made only for scientists, for publishing papers in Nature. This is something that I am expecting to have a very important, let's say, effect on the territory, in the area, spirit of technology transfer for the benefit of our industries. It's, as I said already, it's not the case that all this has happened and will happen in Trieste. Thanks a lot.
Instead of going on along the comments, I would like to profit of the opportunity of opening the Theoretical Quantum Technology Institute in Trieste with a personal recollection that might be useful also for the young people here in the hall. I did my master thesis on Bell's inequality, and at the time the field was considered a sort of philosophical. And I still remember that the head of the commission that declared me a master in physics was, he liked to joke, but at the same time he was the president of the Italian Physical Society and my thesis advisor. And he said to me, "I declare you unemployed in physics." So I always thought of this sentence, and I never said in public about this story, and I never wrote this story in any of my papers. So this is a perfect opportunity to remember this old recollection. It was 1977. I think it can be also a message for the young people to follow curiosity, to which most of the research that then has an outbreak is motivated by curiosity of the scientists. And there are certainly many topics in this area of research that are still puzzling and interesting to go deeper, and also in other areas of physics. I hope that you will have a nice talk with Ignacio Cirac, and have a nice day.
Thank you very much, Stefano Fabrizio. It's great, inspiring words from both of you. Thank you very much. I understand the deputy mayor is here, Paolo Polidori. Would you like to say some words in, coming from the mayor of the piazza? Yes.
Sì, buongiorno a tutti, scusatemi, io potrei affrontare anche un saluto in inglese, ma preferisco rinunciare perché è un po' ruggine, quindi mi capirete lo stesso, mi perdonerete. Porto il saluto ovviamente del sindaco di piazza, che ha avuto un impegno imprevisto e improvviso, quindi porto anche il saluto della città di Trieste. In queste occasioni si nota, e lo noto di persona, come Trieste abbia le sue eccellenze anche in cose che magari non vengono alla luce ogni giorno, magari vedendole passando per la città, ma queste sono quelle eccellenze che danno lustro a questa città, che danno il segno di quanto questi istituti, questa joint venture anche, no, tra i vari istituti possa portare a degli obiettivi e risultati incredibili, da quel poco che ho visto, che sono riuscito a leggere, perché una questione di fondamentale importanza e sarà, vedevo, la crittografia, quindi la gestione anche di nuove formule di scrittura in sicurezza, in modo tale che i dati possano essere protetti nel miglior modo possibile. Io dico, c'è anche un problema di controllo, di chi controlla i dati. Su questo ovviamente la parte scientifica è meno interessata alla cosa, perché l'importante è sviluppare le nuove tecnologie, ma dall'altra parte è altrettanto importante sviluppare che tutte quelle forme di controllo per dare comunque la possibilità di gestire in sicurezza l'enorme progresso che la tecnologia ci offre per quanto riguarda la gestione dei dati. Io vi ringrazio, vi auguro un buon lavoro e di raggiungere gli obiettivi che vi siete prefissati, perché sicuramente sono importanti non solo per Trieste ovviamente, ma per l'umanità intera. Grazie e buona giornata.
Grazie mille, grazie mille. Okay, so before we go to the highlight of this event, we now proceed to the important part, which is the signing of the agreement between the three institutions. So we have here the documents, and you will witness how the three of us sign the three documents.
Should we stay here?
Yes, I think we can
told me that.
Very good. So, well, this is a historical moment for all of us. So I think it was very good. okay, so now is the highlight of this event, is that, of course, all of these activities are because of science, and we always claim that it has to be not only another initiative in science, but we have to have excellence in science. And as a way to demonstrate it, we have to extract the top scientific ideas. And we were extremely lucky to have Ignacio Cirac, who is one of the world leaders in this field of quantum information, he agreed to come and give us a special colloquium. And so let me say a few words about Ignacio. So he, well, he was educated in Spain, in Complutense, but then he was a professor for some time in Innsbruck in Austria, where you know it has been a source of a lot of discoveries in this field. And right now he's a director of Max-Planck Institute in Munich, has been there for several years. And of course, given his big contributions to this field of quantum information, he has several awards, and I can list them: the Prince of Asturias Prize for Science and Technology, the National Prize for Research, the Franklin Medal, the Niels Bohr Medal, the Wolf Prize. That's important for us, unfortunately, because I have to confess he has been always mentioned as a candidate for the Dirac Medal, but we cannot give it because if they have a Wolf Prize, we cannot give the Dirac Medal. But at least that tells you the level that Ignacio has. So recently he got this the Max-Planck Medal from the German Physical Society, which is probably the most prestigious prize given within the country. And in general, it says that it's for his contributions from fundamental mathematical calculations in quantum information theory, modeling of quantum multi-body systems, to concepts for the implementation of quantum optical systems. And so it's a great pleasure to have here Ignacio. He agreed to give a talk, and the talk will be, the title is Quantum Simulations and the Difficulty of Solving Quantum Many-Body Systems. So please join me to welcome Ignacio Cirac.
Thank you. Okay, good morning. First of all, let me congratulate you for this great initiative that you have about this Trieste Institute for Theoretical Quantum Technologies. I think that putting together very strong institutions here in Trieste will make a unique place in the world to develop this field of quantum technologies. So it's a great honor for me and a privilege to be here in this inauguration and to give a talk about quantum technologies. So they asked me that when they asked me to give a talk, that should be, not too complicated, so a little bit more like for, general students of physics and things like that. So the first thing that I have to do is to apologize to the experts, that I see that there are several here in the audience, because some of the things that I'm going to say will be very superficial for them, but nevertheless, I hope that this is good for some of the people. Okay, so you have heard that we are able to tame and control the microscopic world, the world of atoms, molecules, electrons, photons, the world of quantum physics. Then this promises certain applications, and in particular, it provides us new ways of processing information and building computers that promise to make possible the solution of some problems that so far otherwise would be difficult. It also promises us new ways of communications based on quantum physics that would make communications more efficient and secure, and also new ways of sensing. And as I was mentioned in the presentation, so this will for sure have impact in industry and technology, in data processing, and all this everything that comes with the processing of data and artificial intelligence and machine learning and so on. But here I want to focus on some other applications that maybe they are not so much highlighted in the when one presents the world of quantum science and technologies. And this is how this field may also have contributions to change science, and in particular in fields like chemistry, material science, maybe higher energy physics. So this is what I want to concentrate here, so how these quantum technologies, different aspects of these quantum technologies, may affect our development of science itself. And the message that is behind my talk is that some of this science, so in particular the one that study chemical systems or materials or even higher energy physics, actually is typically confronted with a huge challenge when you want to make predictions in these areas. And the reason is that in all these systems, when you want to describe them, then so typically what you do is that you put them on a lattice, so you make a model out of them. And at the end, this lattice corresponds to some particles, some objects which interact with each other, that in physics we describe in terms of some Hamiltonian, and to make predictions about the behavior of these systems is typically connected to studies on quantum mechanical problem, many-body problem on these lattice systems. And even if this lattice systems is composed of the simplest objects, so you would think that in this lattice we would have like a two-level system, a qubit in each of these lattice sites, then if we want to make any prediction, we'll have to solve a quantum mechanical problem. So we'll have to write at the end, the solution will be some state, some quantum state on the system, which even for the case of qubit will be, according to the laws of quantum mechanics, of a linear superposition of all possible configurations. So this means that whenever we want to make predictions, so typically we have to solve a problem, and at the end we have to give what is the wave function that we are studying, and the information is in this coefficient, this coupled coefficient, that appears in each of these configurations. So the general state of our system would be a linear superposition of configuration where all the qubits are in state zero, or all the qubits in state zero and one in one, or the other one in one. And since there are 2 to the n configurations, then it means that we will have to compute and store these 2 to the power n coefficients. And this is an exponential law, so that if we try to do it even with the most advanced computers, we run very soon out of resources. And so in particular, we need an exponential memory. So we need a memory that grows exponentially with the number of lattice sites that we have in the system. And we will require also, because we have to store these 2 to the n coefficients, and it also requires the computation of this coefficient an exponential time, because we will have to do at least one computation for each of the coefficients. So this is the reason behind. So this means that in order to solve many-body problems in physics, chemistry, or high-energy physics, or condensed matter physics, atomic physics, so the resources, the computational resources, both time and memory, have to grow exponentially with the size of the system, with the number of particles that we have, with the volume that we have. And it makes it impossible to solve for whenever we have lattice systems of the order of 30, 40 qubits. We cannot go beyond that. Apart from that, and this will be important with what I said before, so maybe we can trade a little bit of space and for time. So imagine that our computer in which we want to solve this problem is finite, has, let's say, it has 10 to the 80 particles, or the size of the universe, and that you cannot go beyond that. Then can you still solve problems? So you can trade this space for time. So maybe we don't need an exponential space, but then it would take longer to solve these problems, and one can do this computation, and it turns out that then the computational time, so we have only polynomial resources in space, so polynomial, small memory, then the computational time not only grows exponentially with the size of the system, but grows super exponentially. It grows like 2 to the power n to the power n of the system. And so that's a huge increase, and that's why many problems in science, whenever we have to deal with many body systems, become very difficult, impossible, whenever we don't have other methods that approximate the solution. So what I want to say or talk about here is ways around this problem that are offered by quantum technologies, and I will concentrate on 3 different methods. So one of them would be a quantum computer. So how a quantum computer could help us to solve these kind of problems. Then I'll talk about analog quantum simulators, which is an analog version of a quantum computer. And finally, I'll talk about some ideas, more theoretical ideas, coming from the field of quantum information, which is tensor networks, and how tensor networks can help to solve some of these problems. Okay, so let me start with quantum computers. So how if we had a quantum computer, could help to solve the problems that I was mentioning before and to overcome this exponential problem or super exponential problem that we have to deal with when we are solving these problems in physics or chemistry. And that's something that was already realized by Richard Feynman many years ago when he had to give a talk in an island. And this was at the time, so people were concerned about classical computation. And at the time, people were building smaller and smaller computers because they wanted to have them faster, faster, and more powerful. And they were concerned about what will happen if we make them very small and we touch into the quantum mechanics. So classical computers will have to overcome quantum physics, and quantum physics, so it's always related to uncertainty. So probably we'll have problems when we make this computer smaller and smaller. And there is a conference to deal with that problem at that time, and Richard Feynman came up with a completely different problem. So he didn't talk about that, but he said that it's well known that many body problems and problems that appear in physics are very difficult to solve, and that's something that we will have to confront if we had classical computers. However, if we had a quantum computer, that's something that we could solve. And in fact, in the paper that it's here, that was not written by him, but transcribed by somebody from his conference, so he said that he was talking about high energy physics, that if we have a high energy physics problem and we want to make predictions on this high energy physics problem, so the first thing that we can make a lattice out of that, so we can discretize space and time, put two-level systems in space in the lattice, this is what we will call today qubits, and develop a method to compute the evolution of the system just by making these pairs of qubits interact in something that we will call today two-qubit case. So he was describing a quantum computer, and the message behind is that if you have n qubits on a lattice in a classical computer, if you want to describe that, you will have to use 2 to the power n coefficients. That's what I said before, that makes that this exponential dependence on time. However, if you have a quantum system itself, then you can use n of these qubits, yes, to store the state of your system, just prepare the state of your system on that state. So you have a superposition like that. Yes, take n qubits and put your quantum computer in the superposition, and therefore you will have just to measure at the end, and the measure will tell you what are the physical properties that you're interested in. So that was something that was not taking over, so I think until some few years later, by some people who make formulate mathematically this quantum computer. And in fact, already in 1996, so Seth Lloyd came up with a quantum algorithm for a quantum computer to describe, to perform the dynamics of a quantum many-body system. So basically what he said is that if you have a Hamiltonian that describes your interaction of your systems, of your qubits on a lattice or whatever, and you want to compute the evolution operator, just let's what we call trotterize it, just like write in terms of small steps, and each of these steps that you apply after each other would correspond in a quantum computer to different two-qubit gates or quantum gates, and therefore he translated the evolution operator of a quantum system into an algorithm in which is a sequence of 2 and 1 qubit gate. And then he showed that the computational time in a quantum computer would increase like the number of qubits that you have squared times, I mean, this would be just to give you the 8 units of energy, times the time for which you want to simulate the system, everything squared, divided by epsilon, or the epsilon is the error that you tolerate for your system. So he showed that the computational time would increase polynomially, like n squared. And this has to be compared this with this, what I told you before, this super exponential, because here you will have a memory that will be of the order of n qubits. Actually, since the first paper of Seth Lloyd, there have been many papers, and the most efficient algorithm that we have so far for computing the dynamics in a quantum computer of a many-body system is the one by these people here, and it already gives an improvement, so the computational time is now would be linear with the size, with the number of qubits that you have, linear with time, and would decrease with only increase like logarithm of 1 divided by the error, so it's a big improvement. Okay, so what about now, and this, as I mentioned before, this is polynomial time compared to this 2 to the n to the n. No, that would be in a classical computer. So what about the ground state? So imagine that we have now a system, and the system is in thermal equilibrium, and we're interested in describing the physics of this system at zero temperature. So what we say, the ground state of you, we're interested in the ground state of our Hamiltonian. And for example, we're interested in computing the energy or to compute some physical properties related to zero temperature. So with a quantum computer, what we can do is to have an algorithm that prepares the ground state of this Hamiltonian and then measure there, and with that we'll compute the physical observables that we are interested in. And so it turns out that this problem is difficult. So this was shown in a paper by these people in 2006, that this problem in full generality is what is called a QMA hard problem. And the QMA hard problem is people in computer science classify the problems in with respect to their difficulty. And this is a problem that not even a quantum computer could solve, but that a quantum computer can check efficiently. So if you want, is the equivalent to the complexity class, the classical complexity class called NP, which are problems that they're difficult to solve. They're probably exponentially long with a classical computer, but they're very easy to check, so very can be efficiently checked with a classical computer. An example for that is factorization. So it's very difficult. If you give a big number and I tell you to find two factors, then the best algorithm takes a very long time, so almost exponential time, with the number of digits of the system. However, if I give you the factors, it's very simple to check that they are factors because you can just multiply them. And so there is a quantum mechanical version of that. This is QMA, which are problems that are very difficult to solve even with a quantum computer, but can be checked with a quantum computer. So this problem of preparing the ground state or computing the energy of a many-body system, it turns out that this QMA hard. So it's a problem that will take typically exponential time in a quantum computer. So there have been some heuristic algorithms, so some ones that maybe for some problems will work in practice, and that's a very active area of research nowadays. So to find for the first generations of quantum computers some problems that maybe a quantum computer could solve, and with classical computer it will still take this exponential time. But let's say for full generality, this is a problem that is difficult. Okay, so what I want to tell you is now something about an algorithm that we just published of how to find the ground state of a many-body system that that will prepare the ground state of the many-body system given a Hamiltonian, which is a sum of local Hamiltonians. So you can imagine that this is the lattice that I was talking about before. There are qubits or higher level systems in each of the lattice sites. Somebody gives you what is the Hamiltonian, which is maybe a sum of Hamiltonians acting on some small sides of your system, and you like to prepare the ground state. And so since this problem is QMA hard, it means that we cannot aim at something that is better than an exponential. So the computational time for any quantum algorithm that you have would scale exponentially with the number of the lattice sites that you have here. And so the question is, which is this alpha? And also, you have, I mean, this is looks a bit depressive that a quantum computer still takes an exponential time with the size of your system, but you have to compare this with a classical computer, which will take 2 to the n to the power n if you limit the memory, as I mentioned before, if you had only a restricted memory like you have in a, like what you have in a quantum computer. And so let me tell you very, very superficially, so what is the idea of the algorithm? So the idea is that you prepare a random product state. So you put all of your qubits in a random state. So maybe what's in state 0, another one is 0 plus 1, the other one 0 minus 1, you stick with random state. And if you take a random state, then you write now your this random state as a linear superposition of the eigenstates of your Hamiltonian, then typically there will be some overlap with respect to the ground state. And since there are 2 to the power n states, then typically this overlap will be of the order of 1 to the 2 to the n halves, no? Such that the absolute square is 1 divided by 2 to the n. Okay, so you have 2 to the n terms in the sum, so you want to have a normalized state, then each of them will be of the order 1 to the 2 to the n halves. And now what you could do is to measure the energy. And if you measure the energy, then you will obtain some result. And this, of course, will not be the ground state. And only with probability 1 divided by 2 to the n will be the ground state. So you measure of the order of 2 to the n times, and you write down what is the energy that you have. Then at some point, you take the lowest that you had, and then you say it will be a good guess for the ground state energy. This algorithm will take a time which will be of the order of 2 to the n, because you will have to run it 2 to the n times to have a probability of the order of order 1 to have the ground state. However, as I explained, it doesn't work. And it doesn't work because it's not possible to measure the energy of the system. So the energy is this Hamiltonian, which is a sum of Hamiltonians. And in physics, we know how to measure simple observable, but not the sum of observables. So this means that in practice, what I would measure is one of these Hn, maybe H1 here. And if I measure this one, then I will have the average of the energy, not, I will not project the state into the eigenstate. I will have the average, but having the average doesn't tell me anything about what is the ground state of energy of the system. So that's why you have to modify this algorithm to make it useful. And I mean, one of the ideas is to use some Fourier method, and that's, I mean, I will not say what it is, but the basic idea is that out of the initial state, which is this random state, then you can add some auxiliary system, just some auxiliary number of qubits, in such way that with some transformation, with some algorithm, then out of the superposition, you can single out the ground state, put a zero, these auxiliary qubits, and the rest, so all the 2 to the n minus 1 rest, turns out that this auxiliary state is in a state that is orthogonal. And so now you can measure this auxiliary state, and if you find zero, then this certifies that you're in the ground state. And if you do that, then at the end, it will take you have a little bit of an overhead because this step here requires a time, but it only grows logarithmically with the phi zero. This phi zero is the 2 to the n halves, so it's just a linear overhead. So this means that by using this trick, then indeed you will be able, if you repeat 2 to the n times, to find the ground state and to measure the n ground state energy and so on. Actually, there is a slight improvement of that, and this to use what is called amplitude amplification. People call it Grover algorithm, and it turns out that Grover several years ago showed that when you're able to do a transformation that goes from some initial state to some other one, and you can mark the state, so this ancillary is in a state that is orthogonal to the rest, then it's possible just to prepare this state that is here, not with a number, not with a time, not with a required time that goes like this coefficient square, but only like this coefficient. So that's not so important, but it means that in practice, the algorithm that I just told you will have a computational time that will grow like 2 to the power n half. And we believe that that's a tight bound, so there is nothing better that we can prove for that. And that, again, has to be compared with the classical algorithm. Okay, so then it means that if we had a quantum computer, then in principle we could solve problems related to dynamics very efficiently. We could solve problems related to ground state or a thermal equilibrium of systems in a not so efficient way. However, as you know, we don't have a quantum computer, and proof of that is that if you write in Google, so quantum computer, you get pictures like that. Right? However, that is, as it was mentioned in the presentation, actually, during the last 3 or 4 years, there have been a big effort in some companies and industries, the European Union, the American government, the Chinese government, to start building a quantum computer. So there is a big effort worldwide, and that's a tremendous challenge. So maybe at some point we will have a quantum computer. And I have to say that the challenge that is to build a quantum computer is not only a technological one, it's not only experimental one, but actually there is a theoretical challenge behind that, because now one of the main problems of scaling up the prototypes that we have of quantum computers to be quantum computers is that there are errors, and in order to correct these errors in these small quantum computers, you need error correction. And in order to have error correction, you have an overhead. And this means in practice that for each qubit that you require in your quantum computer, you have to have of the order of 10,000 qubits in order to correct of the error. So if your quantum computer requires 10,000 qubits, then in reality you need 10 to the 8 qubits. And this overhead of the error correction, then it could be decreased by 2 or 3 orders of magnitude just by theoretical, let's say, methods, so better error correcting codes. This would boost actually the field of quantum computation. Okay, nevertheless, so this gives me opens up the possibility of maybe trying to solve these many-body problems, not with a quantum computer, because maybe we'll have to wait a little bit for this quantum computer, but with a different method, that's analog quantum simulation. So let me explain you what it is. And the idea of analog quantum simulation is that, again, so imagine that you have one of these problems that at the end you model in a lattice with some Hamiltonian that describes the interaction between the systems that are in the lattice. Now the idea is not to build a quantum computer that can do gates and can perform gates, but to take another system that in the lab you can tame very well, and where you can engineer the interactions, and to make your system in the lab to behave in a way that is described by the Hamiltonian that you want to solve. Okay, so it's a little bit like an analog version of a quantum computer in which you don't do gates anymore, but you just tame your system in such a way that it behaves, that the interactions in your system are the ones that you want to solve. And actually, there are many, many proposals and experiments now of building these analog quantum simulators with atoms in optical lattice, trap ions, quantum dots, superconducting qubits, photons, et cetera, et cetera. And the idea is the same as with Feynman. So the idea is that if you build a quantum system to emulate the physics of a quantum system, then you will never have to store the coefficients of your state because you just prepare your system, your simulator, in that particular state. So then you go ahead, you overcome the problem of the overhead that I mentioned before. So what is the advantage and what are the advantages and disadvantages of analog quantum simulators with respect to quantum computers? Well, the first advantage is that you don't have to be able to, I mean, to have all possible gates, let's say, to build a quantum universal quantum computation, but you have to engineer the interactions only in your system. And so, for example, your system is the problems that you want to solve, as they appear in many systems, are translationally invariant and homogeneous. Then you will have to be able to engineer homogeneous systems. You will have to be precise and engineer a particular Hamiltonian for each of your particular components of your system. But maybe one that is more important is that it's probably much more reliable with respect to errors. And you can qualitatively see it like that. So imagine that this is the Hamiltonian that you want to simulate, and then you have some errors, and the errors are extensive, meaning that at each lattice size, then your Hamiltonian is not exactly the one that you have, but it has some corrections. So this means now that this part of your Hamiltonian may be big, very big, and huge, because it scales with the number of sizes that you have in your system, although the coefficient h that is in front is very small. And so what happens is that in many of these problems, then you're interested in some intensive quantities. So you don't want to know what is the wave function of the whole system. What you want to know is what is the magnetization per particle, the energy per particle. You're interested in the thermodynamic limit. And so therefore, you have to look at intensive quantities. So things like that, observables that are intensive. And so this means that very likely, then the errors will accumulate in an intensive way. So meaning that if this error here is 10% of the Hamiltonian that you have, so typically here you will have that when you measure, when you look at your observable, then you will have a 10% of error in your observable. In a quantum computer, if you have an extensive error, then your quantum computer will not be able to give you any sensible result. Or say, with other words, if you're trying to run a quantum computer with an algorithm, and in the middle of the algorithm, you flip a qubit and continue, at the end, the result that you have will have nothing to do with the result that you're looking for. However, in these systems, I mean, one is the hope that something that is not proven, but then one has the hope that they are more reliable because they are looking at intensive quantities. And so, I mean, people have discussed this with computer scientists many times, and it's very difficult to formulate what I'm saying here in proper mathematical terms, but there is an image that shows that. So one of the first quantum, or the first quantum simulation that was performed was done with atoms in optical lattices, and people were observing quantum phase transition between a superfluid and a Mott insulator. So they wanted to simulate some Hamiltonian, the so-called Boshaver Hamiltonian, and they have errors. And the errors, I mean, you can estimate where this epsilon was of the order of 10%. So there were huge errors. So during the computation, there were huge errors. And they were looking at the phase diagram and then changing the parameters, and they wanted to see whether there was something which was superfluid. Changing the parameters, it was going to something that is called a Mott insulator, and change the parameters maybe back to superfluid. And even though they had very errors, that's the plot. I mean, whatever they plotted, you see that there was a phase transition here. So they were measuring something, and that's exactly what I mean. That even if you add some extensive perturbation, then you can still observe the quantities that you want. And maybe here, they are not so precise. You have a 1% error, 5% error, but that's enough in order, for example, in this case, what they wanted to do is to see whether there are quantum phase transitions and even to characterize some of these phase transitions. So I say that. So actually, one of the systems in which people are doing these quantum simulations, trying to solve many-body problems, the systems are called atoms in optical lattices, as I mentioned before, in which the atoms can tunnel, I mean, they are trapped in some external potentials created by light, by standing wave, and then the atoms can hop from one minimum of this potential to the next one, and also when they are close to each other, then they interact, and this emulates the physics, for example, of electrons that are moving in a solid. And so, in fact, now you can have the experiments with this simulator in which you engineer the interactions between the particles, maybe using the different lasers, using magnetic fields, such a way that at the end, this Hamiltonian can simulate Hubbard-like Hamiltonians. And it's as interesting, this is very interesting, because actually you cannot only simulate bosons, so these atoms could have bosonic character, can be also fermionic character, you can also have some internal states, some spins, you can change the geometries, you can have a square lattice, honeycomb lattice, Kagome lattice, different lines of lattice, or the dimension, you can work in one dimension, two dimensions, and three dimensions. So in fact, this, I think these experiments have had a very big impact in condensed matter physics, and so actually has brought together the field of atomic physics, quantum information, and condensed matter physics. And during the last 5 years, so our group and some other groups, including Marcello, who is here, have been extending this idea of simulation condensed matter using cold atoms in optical lattice to simulate condensed matter physics problems, also to try to simulate high-energy physics problems. And then the idea is that in high-energy physics, you have matter, which are like the fermionic degrees of freedom, and then you have the forces, which are represented by gauge fields, which are bosonic. And so what you can do is that to put this in a lattice, right, a lattice Hamiltonian for any problem, for problems in QCD, QED, and the fermionic will be described now by fermionic atoms, and then the interaction will be mediated by bosonic atoms that are also moving in the lattice, and if you tune the interactions properly, then they correspond to the Hamiltonian that would describe these high-energy physics problems. And I wanted to just to throw some ideas that we have developed lately in order to show how you can do analog quantum simulation of quantum chemistry problems very briefly. And I have to say that the level of experimental difficulty goes exponentially up in this direction. So that's something that people are doing in the lab. There have been first experiments prepared for observing very toy models in high energy physics, and that's something that will require much more effort. But anyway, so I'm a theorist, and I've, during my life, have seen the things that you propose that look impossible today, I mean, in a few years, look possible. Okay, and so what is the main idea of this paper that we just submitted? Well, the idea is that when you have a chemical problem, so you can think in terms of Born-Oppenheimer approximation, so that's one that the typical quantum chemists do very often, in what you would like to do is, for example, to see what happens if you have a nuclear set at some positions, and so what is the equilibrium of the nuclear? So is there the nuclear at different positions, then you have some electronic state for this nuclear, and this will have certain energy. So you fix, you put a, like an infinite mass, the nuclear, and then you find what is the ground electronic state for your system, and this gives you an energy. Now you change the position of the nuclear, and then you will get a different energy. So what you have is a landscape of the energy as a function of the position of the nuclear, and now you look at what is the minimum of this landscape, and this would be the configuration where the nuclear at equilibrium positions. And that's something that people in quantum chemistry are interested in. And once you have this configuration, this is the form that the molecule will have, the geometry that the molecule will have, then you can study, so what is the energy, what are the excitation, what are the physical properties, and so on. And the idea is to do something similar with atoms in optical lattices. And so in this Born-Oppenheimer approximation, then what you have is that, so there is a nuclear Hamiltonian, which is classical because you fix the position of the nuclear. Then you have the kinetic energy of the electrons, so the electrons can still move. Then the interactions, the electrons interact with the nuclear, so they are attracted by the Coulomb interaction. But the electrons also interact with each other through the electron-electron interaction. As I mentioned before, what you would like to do is to find what is the ground state of this Hamiltonian for some fixed position of the nuclei, and at the end, as we compute the energy, and as you will find what is the minimum, is the stable configuration of your system. And so what's the idea, I mean, the with cold atoms in optical lattice? So first of all, to do it on a lattice, so to have a big lattice, in which now you will have electrons will be represented in this lattice by some fermionic atoms. The fermionic atoms can move in the lattice, can hop in the lattice, and would represent the kinetic energy. And if the lattice is sufficiently big, and then you go to the continuum limit, then this would represent this term in your Hamiltonian, the kinetic energy of the electrons. Then to have some external lasers will push the electrons, actually, that will attract electrons, and this would correspond to the Coulomb interaction of the nuclei. So we have thought, so how you can use holographic methods in order to create something that decreases like 1 over r in such a way that these atoms get attracted by these nuclei. This would be this part of the interaction. And then for the repulsion between the fermions to represent the electron-electron interaction. So what we do is we copy nature. So it's, I mean, these atoms in optical lattices are neutral atoms, so they will not repel each other with a 1 Coulomb interaction. So, I mean, maybe they have a van der Waals interaction, 1 over R6. So, but the idea is to introduce a boson atom in such that the boson atom somehow interacts with the fermion and interacts with the other fermion and mediates interaction in as much as the same way as electrons interact with photons and the photons mediate the Coulomb interaction. So we figure out a way of doing that, and that's what is our proposal. Okay, so with that, I would like to go to the third part of my talk. So I was talking about many-body problems, and so how quantum computer can help to solve some of these problems. If we don't have a quantum computer, maybe an analog quantum simulator. And now I'm going to change and try to look for some other possibility, and these are tensor networks. So this is not a quantum computer, it's not a quantum analog, so this would be some mathematical methods to solve these problems, and that are inspired in part, at least, by the quantum information theory. And as you know, so revolution in science that occurred, the last physics, quantum physics and information theory, now can join together in what is called now quantum information theory. And that's the theory that is behind the quantum computers, the quantum communication systems, and so on. So people, especially in the 90s, sat down and tried to translate the Shannon information theory to quantize it in order to describe now the states of quantum computers and so on, and try to figure out so how to use quantum computers, how to prove that quantum communication is secure, et cetera, et cetera. And the idea is to be inspired by some of the developments in quantum information theory to try to attack many-body problems with a different angles than the ones that have been used so far. And so the idea is that in quantum information, when you have a quantum computer, so people were asking, so if I have a quantum computer, why is it much more powerful than a classical computer? And so, in fact, if your quantum computer would be in a product state, so the qubits in your quantum computer are never entangled, then, I mean, it's very easy to show that you cannot get any advantage with respect to a classical computer, because you could describe this product state with of the order of n parameters. You just have to say what is the state of each of your system, so everything grows polynomially, so there is no advantage. So it seems that whenever you don't have product states, namely when you have entanglement, then is when you have some gain in a quantum computer. So that's why people saw that entanglement is a resource in quantum physics. So let's study entanglement, and let's ask questions like, how entangled is a quantum computer during a quantum computation? And now you can translate the same question to many-body systems, not a quantum computer, but one of these problems that we were talking about. So you have now a problem in high-energy physics, or you have a problem in condensed matter physics or atomic physics, these that have these exponential coefficients. So how entangled are the states? And it's very clear that if the states are not entangled, then you could have a method to solve that would not require this exponential overhead that I mentioned before. And what happens is that if they're little entangled, whatever this means, maybe it's simple to solve these problems. And that's a little bit the idea behind these tensor networks. The idea is that in nature, in some problems in nature, especially if you are in thermal equilibrium and you have local interactions, that's important to have the two things, local interactions and thermal equilibrium, then it turns out that the states that appear in your system are not very general. Actually, they can be parameterized by the possible Hamiltonians, and since the Hamiltonians are local, then the number of parameters that you can, which you can describe all these problems is very little. So this means basically that the states that appear in nature, in local interactions and thermal equilibrium, actually are in a corner of this exponentially big Hilbert space, which is physically relevant. And so the idea would be, so what happens if we have now a description that allows to
address very efficiently this corridor of Hilbert space, but maybe not so good the rest of the Hilbert space. But that's, since this is the physically relevant, then we could describe our system. So how could you identify what is the relevant part of the Hilbert space where the dynamics occurs in the system? And this has come by asking questions, so how entangled are these states? And it turns out that the states that fulfill the condition that I told you before are very little entangled as opposed to what they could be. So they fulfill the so-called area law. So if you take a system in one of these states and you look at the entanglement between some region and the rest, then the entanglement is not extensive. It does not increase with the volume of your system, which is what would happen if you take a random state in Hilbert space, but only increase with the perimeter, with the area, with the surface area. And so this makes that the states that appear in nature, under the condition that I mentioned before, are very, very special, are in this corner of Hilbert space. So maybe we, instead of treating all the states in Hilbert space on equal footing, like we do when we write wave functions, there is another way of treating them specially, and that's what tensor network aims at. And so tensor networks, what it tells you is that when you write your state in a superposition, then the coefficients that appear here can be considered to be a tensor. So for each configuration, you have a complex value. And the idea of tensor networks is to write this tensor with many coefficients. So this leads to this huge dimension, or due to the huge dimension of the Hilbert space, in terms of smaller tensors that with few coefficients that are contracted among themselves. So to write a big tensor with many coefficients, it's terms of very small tensors that are contracted among each of them. And so what you will have to store, what you have to compute in practice will be this small tensor. So the number of parameters, since there is one tensor per lattice size, will scale only like n or polynomially in n, except of exponentially. And so, I mean, pictorially speaking, what we want to do with tensor networks is to just take the state of our system, which is represented like a big tensor, and to write it in terms of these small tensors, which have the legs, the original legs, plus some other auxiliary legs that are contracted with each other, such a way that we can approximate the whole state instead of these tensors. And the gain that we have is that instead of storing and computing all these coefficients, we'll have to compute the coefficients of all these small tensors, which are much less. And of course, if you try to do that for a state in the, here in the middle of the Hilbert space, this will not be possible, or in fact, this small tensor will not be that small. So these indices that are here will have exponential dimensions. However, the hope, and actually what can be proved in some cases, is that it is possible indeed to have descriptions that are very efficient with small tensors as long as you are in this corner of Hilbert space. And this happens especially with these projected entangled per states, which are tensors that have this configuration. They have the geometry of your lattice. And in this case, it has been proven, so lately in this paper here, that you have a state thermal equilibrium at any finite temperature, and with a local Hamiltonian, then you can approximate it in terms of one of these PEPs, in which the number of coefficients that you have only scales polynomially with the size of your system, not exponentially. So that's something that, as I mentioned, has been proven. So this gives a hope that maybe using this tensor description, then we can address some of the problems in many-body systems. Actually, these PEPs is nothing else but a generalization to higher dimension of something that was well known in condensed matter physics that are called matrix product states. And I have to say that there are other tensor networks that are very interesting from some other points of view, like this MERA introduced by Giffre some years ago. Okay, so people have been now been able to do some computations using these tensor networks, and in particular, in one dimension, let's say in one spatial dimension, one plus one dimensional, this has happened already many years ago, and it was a success. It's basically due to what is called the density matrix renormalization group algorithm. But the challenge was to go to higher dimensions, but it seems that in the last couple of years, there have been a big advance in using this tensor, these PEPs in this 2 plus 1 dimensional system. So already some time ago, so Philippe Corbeau and collaborators were able to use these PEPs and to get very accurate results for the TJ model. Now, during the last couple of years, there has been these Simon collaborations in which they have taken different methods and tried to solve the Hubbard model for different methods, and PEPs have played a very important role there, and so now they have a phase diagram for the Hubbard model, And if you talk to Philippe Corbot, who is also the person who is behind these computations with PEPS, now they can see the physics of stripes, they can put nearest neighbor interactions, they can do two-band models, three-band models, so I think that now they're able to solve many of the problems that seemed to be very difficult last year, and also Philippe Corbot with collaborators has been able to solve some other models and very accurate with this method. So it seems that indeed these tensor networks may help to solve some of the problems, or is adding a new tool to solve many of the systems, as long as you're in thermal equilibrium and with local interactions. So in fact, for you want to compute dynamics, still there is no method that I know that would give you this polynomial overhead. So still will scale exponentially with whatever you do, even in practice probably. Well, so to finish up, just let me say that this tensor network is not only able to describe states, but you can describe observable operators using this tensor network description. You can describe maps. For example, you can describe maps that map bulk properties into boundary properties. So you can have holographic principles described by these maps. You can work with any dimension and also geometry. So for example, you can use a hyperbolic geometry, put your tensor networks in your hyperbolic geometry, and you can use it to describe bosons, fermions, and even anions in these systems. And that's why the field of tensor networks, apart from being used to solve problems numerically, they have been used also, for example, to introduce symmetry-protected topological phases. So I'm very happy to hear that Xiaowen Wen got this Dirac Medal this year. And among the many things that he did is he introduced symmetry-protected topological phases using tensor network language. You can also use bulk boundary correspondence. People have lately applied these tensor networks to solve some lattice gauge theory models. They have also made some toy models using this hyperbolic geometry of ADS-CFT models. These tensor networks are also using quantum information in one-way quantum computing. Quantum error correcting codes, surface codes, can also be written in terms of tensor networks. So people are using this language of tensor networks also to describe that, some sequentially generalized state. And also, they have appeared in mathematics, so independently, and so they were discovered independently in many places. So I think that tensor networks can be rediscovered over and over during the years, and in particular in mathematics, it seems that there is also a very important area of research. Okay, so with that, I would like to finish. So saying that quantum science and technology promises impact in society and industry, but maybe also in science. And in particular, it can help in different ways to address some of the problems that are difficult in science, especially when you have quantum many-body systems. I told you here so how we believe that quantum computers through quantum algorithms can help to solve of these problems. Analog quantum simulators may also give help. And in fact, these experiments are very advanced, so their claims that people have been able to simulate problems that are interesting and that we cannot solve with classical computers already, and also the field of tensor networks, which is just putting together a little bit of quantum information with condensed matter physics, with the expertise of people also in high energy physics looking at area loss, I think that has been very rich. So if I have to say something that is very impressive from the point of view of quantum science and technology, is the connection that it has with many areas of physics. So I've been working in this area for the 90s, and in the 90s, quantum information theory had a very clear connection with quantum optics because people were trying to build quantum computers, quantum simulations with quantum optical systems, and also with solid-state physics because they also were building quantum computers and quantum simulations. But it seems that this has extended a lot, and it's not only, let's say, the building quantum computers and quantum simulation which is very attractive, but also the language. So people in quantum information learn a lot from condensed matter physics, high energy physics, quantum gravity, quantum chemistry. And for example, last year I went to more meetings on, let's say, quantum gravity than to quantum information theory, because there are many, many connections, and this is becoming really a great place. So in Munich, we have started a center for quantum science and technology as well, not theoretical, it's more experimental. But anyway, one important part of our research is to try to make connections between quantum information and high energy physics, quantum cosmology, even quantum chemistry. And I think that that's something that is opening up for the students, not only to work on the technology part, but also on the scientific part. And I would like to end Yes, thanking the members of my department. So we are many people in our department. So we are three staff members, Norbert Schuch, Marie Carmen Bagnus, who is not here. But I want to also to highlight that we have several Italians, people coming from Trieste. So Lorenzo Piroli did a PhD here. Tommaso Guaita did his master's thesis here. And Giuliano Giuducci is visiting. He's from the group of, he's from here actually, for ICTP, and he's visiting for some months. And we also have some Italian people. So with that, I would like to thank SISSA, ICTP, and also the university because of this new center. Congratulate for this new center and hope that they will still be educating students and bringing them abroad and we can take advantage from them as well. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much. This was a great, great, great talk, actually. Really enjoyed it. Do you mind taking some questions? Any questions? Comments? Please. Huh? Yes, please.
Concerning your simulation of the electronic molecular problem, in order to simulate the Coulomb interaction, you not only you need the bosons, you also need massless bosons. How can you take out the mass on?
Actually, there would be one possibility to have massless photons if you would go to a part of your dispersion relation which is linear. So I mean, these are moving in lattice. So in principle, the energy of these bosons can not only be, let's say, near zero momentum, but could be in the linear part of the dispersion relation. In this case, it would be massless. But this is not what we use. So we use some other tricks that using the internal levels of the atoms, then you can have some virtual interactions, which is not exactly the same as what you have with, let's say, Dirac, also with quantum electrodynamics. But with some other more tricks from atomic physics is how we do that.
Thank you.
Cheers.
Yeah, so this appearance of hyperbolic geometry, is it something optional or is there the appearance of hyperbolic geometry that you mentioned, is it something optional or is there some system where it naturally has a hyperbolic geometry?
Well, this was optional. This was mathematical. So you can just consider a lattice which has any geometry and some people have taking hyperbolic geometry. That does not correspond to a physical system as far as I know, but it's the way in which, for example, people have built in Stanford some ADS-CFT toy models in which they put these tensor networks in that geometry and then they represent the ADS, the bulk represents the ADS geometry, the hyperbolic geometry, and the boundaries where the conformal field theory should be. But that's more from the mathematical point of view. So there is no physical system that I know that has such a geometry.
Saru?
So it's about the first part. So can you map the ground state search, the ground state problem in a like Grover like database search, or is something different?
Well, this is it's. It's something different, so because you have to be able, I mean, for Grover algorithm, you have to be able to mark your state. So how do you mark the ground state? You don't know what is the energy. And so that's the first part of the algorithm. It's an algorithm that will mark your ground state by putting some ancilla. And when you have that, in principle, you could measure, and then you could find the ground state. That was the first part. But then you can put on top of that Grover because you can mark, you have an ancilla now in a different way, and then going back and forth, then you can use Grover in order to speed up.
So the square root speed up is Grover.
The square root is Grover. Is using that. Yeah.
So suppose you want to quantum analog simulate a chaotic billiard, quantum chaotic billiard. What are the signatures of the fact that the classical limit is chaotic?
It's a good question. So because I guess that in principle should be more difficult to simulate, like it's even a classical simulation of a chaotic system. I mean, you have exponential spread out.
And so here, I think that people in quantum, well, you know this better than me, but quantum, in quantum systems, what happens if you have a small perturbation of your Hamiltonian, then your trajectory will, quantum trajectory will diverge very much with respect to the original one. So I guess that one, what could do is to evolve with two different Hamiltonians, make an interference effect. One of them is a little bit perturbed with respect to the other one, and this will tell you that the overlap decreases exponentially, something like Loch-Schmidt echo. And I think that people show that in the classical limit, so you have a system that the problem in the h-bar is going to zero, I mean the one that you define h-bar goes to zero, then this would recover the Lyapunov exponent for the classical system, so there would be a way. I mean, now that's a very fashionable system to study quantum chaos because they also related to SYK models, quantum gravity, and so on, and people have been proposing experiments in order to observe, let's say, quantum chaos with those systems, and I guess that some of the proposals are required to make this kind of interference effect if you change a little bit your Hamiltonian.
Questions? Just a couple of short questions. When you had this kind of a Venn diagram with a polynomial, non-polynomial, this QMA, you had another branch called QBP or something.
BQP.
What is that?
Okay, so BQP is kind of the equivalent of P for quantum. So it's bounded quantum polynomial. So it means that these are problems that a quantum computer can solve efficiently, probabilistically. Quantum computer typically works probabilistically. Okay. And so these are the problems that I would say, roughly speaking, the problems that a quantum computer can solve efficiently. And they are different than NP. So P is included,
yes,
that. So the classical polynomial are included in the quantum. It includes part of NP because factoring problem, for example, is there.
Okay.
It probably does not include all NP because there is, I mean, NP-hard problems, so three SAT problems probably cannot be solved by a quantum computer.
Okay.
And, but it also has, people believe, problems that are not even in NP, not even in what is called BPP, which is the probabilistic classical problem. So it's a very complex, as people call a zoo of complexity classes, and when you put quantum physics, it's more complex.
And can you define which of the NP problems can be of this class?
We only know examples. We only know examples. So in fact, it's not known whether NP is equal to BPP, or even if NP is equal to P. Okay, so that's one of the, I mean, the millennial problem, no?
Okay, yeah. Very good. And in your analog simulations, you were able, I mean, people are able to simulate gauge interactions, for instance. Is it doable to think about simulating gravitational interactions?
Okay, so what you can do, and people have been proposing, is to use, to simulate quantum field theories with in core space, so with back reaction to gravity. Mm-hmm. So the problem is that if there would be back reaction, then you should have something like a quantum gravity theory. And so since there is no theory for that, this may be possible. So there are people in which have been also proposing how to have semi-classical gravity, and this can be included, and there have been proposals as well. But of course, I guess that if one would be able to put gravity there, then this could maybe help us to understand some of the problems of quantum gravity.
Okay. So let's thank Ignacio again for such a great talk.